2025 is only halfway over, and space has already delivered this year, from finding new things, learning new things, discovering new things, from DNA building blocks found on an asteroid, to moon count explosion on Saturn, to maybe signs of life on a distant world. This year has been wild, so in this video, I'm breaking down my favorite space stories from each month so far. Let's get into it. All right, 2025 kicked off with something incredible, and it feels like a lifetime ago. NASA dropped results from its OSIRIS-REx mission, which brought back samples from the asteroid Bennu. And no big deal, but it was found to contain the building blocks of life. Let's break that down. Now, Bennu is an ancient carbon-rich asteroid that's basically a time capsule from the early solar system, kind of like a frozen snapshot of what was floating around almost 5 billion years ago. And now that scientists are analyzing the sample, what they've found is really, really cool. First off, they found 14 of the 20 amino acids essential for life on Earth. These are the little molecules that make up proteins, basically the stuff that life is made of. And not only that, they also found all 5 nucleobases, the compounds that make up DNA and RNA, the whole set. But not strictly DNA in its complete form, just the compounds that make it up. But here's where it gets even cooler. Bennu's sample also showed signs of ancient salt water, actual evidence that water was involved in the chemical reactions on the asteroid or its parent body from where it came from. And in that watery environment were high levels of nitrogen and ammonia, which are kind of like chemical power-ups when it comes to building even more complex organic molecules. Now, does this technically mean we found life on Bennu? No, but it does mean that the ingredients for life were likely floating all over the solar system from the very beginning. And if these chemicals were forming on Bennu, they were probably forming everywhere else too. And that changes how we think about life in the universe. Maybe Earth isn't that special. I never thought it was, to be completely clear. And maybe life isn't rare either. And this isn't just speculation. This is lab-confirmed chemistry from a rock that's older than Earth. And we've only just started scratching the surface of analyzing this data, so who knows what else is lying in that cosmic dirt. Now, February gave us a bit of spacey suspense, courtesy of asteroid 2024 YR4. This asteroid was discovered right after Christmas in 2024. Now, initially it was placed on NASA's Sentry Risk Table, which keeps an eye on potential Earth impactors. And then the real drama started. The impact probability kept jumping around and kept rising. Here's how it played out. January 27, a 1.2% chance of impact on December 22, 2032. By February 5, that went up to 1.9%. February 11, 2.3%. Then by February 18, it peaked at 3.1%, the highest impact probability ever recorded on the Sentry system's history. And then it went down to 1.5% the next day, 0.28% on February 20, then 0.005% on February 23, and then finally by February 27, it was at 0.0011%. Basically, this asteroid went from mildly concerning to we need to dock, and then all the way back down to never mind, it's fine. And now it's been completely removed entirely from NASA's Sentry Risk Table. So that means astronomers have gathered enough data to be confident it won't hit us on Earth in 2032, which is a huge relief and a great demonstration of how the planetary defense system is supposed to work. But supposedly the impact probability of it hitting the moon has gone up. I don't remember what the actual number is, but I'll look it up and put it down below here, because that would be cool to watch if it hits the moon. In March, Saturn decided to flex on the rest of the solar system by picking up 128 new moons. Yeah, 128 tiny new moons were officially added to Saturn's growing moon collection, bringing the grand total up to 274 moons. That's more than every other planet combined. So what are these things? Now, they're called irregular moons, tiny potato-shaped little objects only a few kilometers across. You can kind of think of them like cosmic crumbs, not spherical, not symmetrical, just little blobby moonlets that are orbiting through around Saturn. Now they've been given temporary names like S/2020 S27 for now, which, yeah, kind of sounds like a printer error, I get that. But real names are potentially coming for the most notable ones, and they'll likely come from Norse mythology. That's because Saturn's irregular moons are grouped by their orbits, and most of these new ones fall into what's called the Norse group. So get ready to meet some obscure Viking giants in the years ahead, because naming over 100 tiny moons is going to take some creativity. The discoverers, led by Dr. Edward Ashton, will get to suggest names, and who knows, maybe your favorite Norse figure will finally make the cut. Now, will all 128 get names? Not necessarily. The IAU only names moons over about 3 kilometers wide, unless they're scientifically interesting, like I said before. So some may stay in their little alphanumeric disguise forever. But either way, Saturn is just absolutely killing it and is the king of moons in the solar system right now. April truly sent the space world buzzing with headlines claiming that we found the best evidence yet for life on a distant planet. And it all centered on the exoplanet K2-18b, about 124 light years away. The claim? A research team said they detected dimethyl sulfide or dimethyl disulfide, gases that on Earth are mostly produced by life, especially ocean plankton. If true, that would make them biosignatures, potential signs of life. But potential is doing a lot of heavy lifting here. The scientists did say this signal wasn't strong enough to confirm anything. Yet still, the lead author said in a press release that a Haitian world teeming with life is what best fits the data. And well, that quote was everywhere. So did we find aliens? No. Is the planet interesting? Absolutely. But we don't even agree on what kind of planet this is yet. It could be a Haitian ocean world, or a mini Neptune, or even something as intense as a lava ocean planet, which is very much not good for life as we know it, so who knows? Like, it was a moment of real excitement, and maybe a little bit too much hype, but hey, that's where May comes in, because in May, science did what science does best. It followed up, because several new studies looked at the same data from K2-18b, and let's just say the bold claims didn't quite hold up. Those supposed biosignatures disappeared. These follow-ups used improved models and expanded the chemical analysis. Instead of just testing for 20 possible gases, one team tested 90 and found that more than 50 matched the data and they had nothing to do with life. The strongest candidate was a boring hydrocarbon called propane. Not exactly pointing towards alien plankton. But look, the bottom line is what was first seen as a potential biosignature now looks more like just ordinary chemistry, not extraterrestrial biology. And honestly, that's okay. This is how good science works. Bold ideas get tested and challenged and, if needed, rolled out. So no, this wasn't the discovery of alien life that we'd hoped for, we were always hoping, but it was another step closer to learning what life could look like if and when we do find it. Fingers crossed. And yes, there was also a follow-up paper from the original research team that expanded their search to even more molecules and still found that dimethyl sulfide and dimethyl disulfide were the best matches to the data. But from what I understand in their follow-up paper, they didn't really improve the statistics of that signal. So in my opinion, it didn't give more weight to their original claims. All right, moving on to June. And this one's got a twist. You know that classic idea that the Milky Way and Andromeda are on a collision course and we're all just waiting for those cosmic fireworks in 5 billion years' time? Well, new research turned that idea on its head. A team of scientists took over a decade's worth of data from both Hubble and Gaia and ran a staggering 100,000 simulations to figure out what's really going on and what will happen in the future. Now, they looked at 22 different factors that could affect whether or not these two galaxies are actually going to crash into each other in the next 10 billion years. So here's what they found. Turns out, in about half of those simulations, the Milky Way and Andromeda don't actually collide head-on. Instead, they pass by each other, separated by about 500,000 light years, roughly 5 times the size of the Milky Way, and then they come back together much further in the future. They'll still merge, just not in the dramatic head-on crash that we're kind of expecting. But it gets even more interesting. In most of the other simulations, the two galaxies never merge at all. They just kind of dance around each other for the next 10 billion years without ever locking together. So that head-on collision we've all heard about happening in 4-5 billion years or so, well, that scenario did show up, but it only showed up in about 2% of the simulations. The game changer seems to be that the satellite galaxies that are orbiting around the Milky Way and Andromeda are playing a bigger role than was ever expected. Now, these smaller galaxies, like the Large Magellanic Cloud around the Milky Way and M33 around Andromeda, could be influencing the way the two larger galaxies are moving. Now, these satellite galaxies could be altering the galaxy's paths enough to prevent that dramatic head-on collision we were all bracing for. So while the Milky Way and Andromeda might still merge eventually, the scenario is looking less like a head-on crash and more like a slow cosmic dance over the next 10 billion years. But still, it's down to a coin flip, really. And before we wrap up, let's take a moment for some honorable mentions from the year so far. First, ever wondered what a meteor sounds like when it crashes to Earth? Well, wonder no more, because for the first time, we heard the sound of a meteor impact on Earth, and it was caught on tape in Canada. Check it out. I know, I was a little disappointed too. Next, Hubble dropped a 2.5 billion pixel mosaic of the Andromeda galaxy, revealing over 200 million stars. The southern disk is way more disturbed than the northern one, which hints at a wild history of galactic collisions. A train wreck of a galaxy, some scientists say. JWST gave us our first look at auroras on Neptune, and the Vera C. Rubin Observatory released its first test images, and they were just incredible. And that's everything interesting that's happened in the world of space in 2025 so far, at least according to me. But there's still plenty of the year left, so who knows what the universe has in store for us next. But no matter what it is, I'll be here to share it all with you, because I can't stop yapping about space. Stay curious and keep looking up.